Center this Friday. I'm your host, Ingrid Nantege, and we have a very exciting show lined up for you and a very, very exciting guest. And because it's all things entertainment and lifestyle, I'll be joined later on in the show by Miss World Kenya, none other than Sharon Abobara. But of course, my co-host, Stephanie Wasso, will also be joining us later to talk about the trending topics of the week. But first, we'll start this hour off with the stories that are making headlines. Kenyans are yet to come to terms with the recent upward review of fuel prices that has pushed the cost of living through the roof. With a battered economy, many are forced to make hard decisions on their spending in order to maximize on the limited resources. Others say loans will have to come in handy if they have to survive irrespective of the ability to repay.
Na bei ya vitu lazima itapanda na uchumi utakuwa mgumu na watu watatisika sana.
Customers wangu hawafiki bei. Na kama customers wangu wafiki bei, inamaanisha mapato yangu kwa siku inaenda chini.
Maisha ni ngumu kusema ukweli, fare iko juu sana. Alafu venye mafuta imeongezeka, unajua barabara sasa usafiri mali pa kuenda na 40, saizi wanaitisha 70 ama 60.
Juu kama hii pikipiki tulikuwa tunaweka kama 300, 400, na kwa saa hii inabidi uweke 500, na still huwezi ifikisha ile target ulikuwa nayo juu. Hata kasoma juu ya transportation ya gari kukuja hapa kwa kazi imekuwa gumu.
Maisha kwangu imekuwa ngumu sana kwa sababu maisha imepanda juu. Kiti ya kwanza mafuta imepanda. Hii kazi yangu natumia mafuta. Mafuta imepanda sana. Sasa leo maziwa imepanda ni 55. Kwa mtu wa chini tunapata shida sana.
Vile vitu ulikuwa unafanya budget ya mwezi kwa mwezi itabidi sasa upunguze. Kama ni wakati mwingine utakuwa unafuka unaruka kunywa chai ndio at least upate chakula ya mchana.
Tuseme ikiwezekana ndaishi kwa nyumba ya chini zaidi.
Sasa itawa hata kukula itakuwa ni kama once per day. Juu hiyo breakfast inakuwa ni expensive sana.
Mahali naishi lazima niteremke. Siwezi hisi ile nyumba nilikuwa naishi. Lazima nitafute hata kama ni ghetto. Ili niweze kulisa familia yangu na pikipiki, nilipe mwenyewe juu, nikikaa nyumba yenye iko juu, mwenyewe atapelekewa pesa.
Kitu ya kwanza sitakunywa maziwa, nitakunywa chai rangi bwana. Nikipona nikinywa katurungi kidogo, nitakuwa nimepunguza. Kitu ya pili sitakula nyama.
Itabidi sasa kama simu yako inakuruhusu upate loan, itakubidi uchukue.
Ni ngumu kuchukua juu, ukichukua kulipa itakuwa shida. Hakuna pesa ya kulipa. Unaweza chukua useme naingiza kwa biashara. Biashara iko chini kusema ukweli.
Hata nikichukua loans na nifulize bado itoshi. Manake kwa sasa hivi naishi na loans.
Kama hii mswali ama nini, itabidi tusidwe hata kuilipa ya sisi wenyewe. Juu pesa yenyewe utaigawanyisa aje.
Lazima nichukue roni bwana. Hakuna mtu hawezi endelea bila loan.
Pressure is now mounting on the government to look into the high fuel prices after the Energy Regulatory Authority released the new prices. Amani National Congress Party leader Musalia Mudavadi is calling on the government to review the high fuel prices, saying they're pushing Kenyans to the economic edge. Mudavadi says the increased pump prices will affect the cost of production, which will eventually lead to high cost of pricing of goods and services.
Serikali iliongeza bei ya mafuta. Kwa njia ambayo tunashangaa. Kwa hivyo mwito wetu ni kwa serikali ni kwamba serikali, tafadhali wananchi wanaumia, COVID imewafinya, uchumi umewafinya, punguza hii mambo ya kuongeza ushuru kwa mafuta kwa sababu inaumiza mwananchi.
The Controller of Budget and Commission on Revenue Allocation have faulted both the Parliament and National Treasury for the current debt crisis following the government's shift from borrowing cheaper long-term loans to short-term and more expensive loans. The two offices are now recommending renegotiations of debt repayment agreements and slowing down of borrowing that has seen the government use 64% of its tax revenue collected to service foreign debts.
Debt service crowds out other important expenditure. And again, remember, honorable members, COVID comes and it's a crisis that comes when you're already vulnerable, and then our revenues contract. But our debt service payments can't contract.
Each loan agreement, each credible loan agreement must have an exit clause. Now that exit clause is usually crafted in favor of the lender, but that doesn't mean it cannot be done. Indeed, it would be better that we bite the bullet at once and make that payment that can stop us from paying forever. Because as long as we don't draw down that loan, Chairman, we must continue paying the commitment fees. We should encourage counties to increase their source revenue by whatever means, if it is the technology, if it is the staffing, whatever it is that will help them raise their own source revenues, that is what will get us out of this trap, not more borrowing.
To the COVID-19 situation in the country, and Kenya is set to receive the first consignment of Pfizer COVID-19 vaccines this afternoon. This will boost Kenya's war against coronavirus as the Ministry of Health ramps up vaccination. At the same time, Kenya will receive its first batch of China's Sinopharm COVID-19 vaccine tomorrow. On Thursday, the country reported 511 new cases of coronavirus. According to Health CS Mutahi Kagwe, the new infections were from a sample size of 7,955 tests with a positivity rate of 6.4%. 12 more people have also succumbed to the disease, raising cumulative fatalities to 4,961. In terms of vaccination, Kenya has so far administered 3.24 million doses of COVID-19 vaccines with over 844,000 people having been fully vaccinated. Agriculture Cabinet Secretary Peter Munya maintains that ongoing reforms in the tea subsector are unstoppable. The CS has emphasized that the sole purpose of the reforms is to streamline green leaf collection and curb exploitation of farmers. Speaking this morning, Munya said the reforms will mitigate against declining earnings by the smallholder tea growers.
For the last 5 years, the earnings have been going down, 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 down. What was being done is public relations. In July 2021, a minimum bonus for the last financial year amounting to Kenya shillings 1.3 billion was paid to the smallholder tea growers. I remember the previous board refusing to pay, even as we were telling them. I don't know where they wanted to take this 1.3 billion. In order to cushion the farmers against the high cost of fertilizer, KTDA, through my ministry, has requested the government of fertilizer subsidy amounting to Kenya shillings 1 billion, which will reduce the cost of fertilizer. Even though I've seen that, I would want to make it very clear that this fertilizer was purchased by the board that was there. I don't think these prices, looking at the prices available locally and the price they bought this fertilizer, I don't think the factors we are raising were the only factors. I think somebody inflated the costs, and the investigations are being done by the agents that is doing investigations will also look into this particular purchase. Since the setting up of a minimum reserve price, average tea prices for the smallholder teas have recorded a 40% increase at the auction.
We will work closely with the Minister of Agriculture to ensure a full implementation of the reforms. We want to ensure that the small-scale farmer get value for their tea they produce. Moving forward, we shall embark on face-to-face lead meeting with farmers across the country to hear their grievances and to find out the actual solution to this problem. We want a more participatory approach to tea business and not top-down approach, as there has been the case.
Now, Equity Bank has received 2 international standard certifications on IT service and information security management systems, cementing its commitment to prioritizing customer safety and satisfaction. The British Standards Institution issued the 2 certifications. In his remarks, Equity Group Managing Director and CEO Dr. James Mwangi noted that the recognition was a testament to the bank's significant investment in data analytics and cybersecurity capabilities to better meet its evolving customer needs and expectations, as well as to reduce the potential for data breaches. Kilifi County Government, in partnership with Safaricom Foundation, have commissioned a modern newborn unit at the Kilifi Referral Hospital to provide quality maternal health care services. Through the 60-bed capacity facility, the county aims to reduce infant mortality rates, encourage skilled newborn care, and decrease neonatal complications. The renovated unit will cater for at least 20 newborns at a time, an improvement from 5 newborns. The initiative is part of Safaricom Foundation's 132 million shillings maternal, newborn and child health program, which includes over 30 million shillings for the construction and equipping of maternal and newborn facilities in Lamu and Mombasa.
Kuna faida kubwa ikiwa serikali na mashirika sokuwa ya kiserikali yatashikana mikono kwa minajili ya kuleta miradi ambayo itafanikisha na kuleta huduma bora kwa wananchi. Na hilo ndilo lilofanyika katika sekta hii ya afya hapa Kilifi. Baada ya kufanya makadirio yetu ya kufanikisha mradi huu, ilibainika wazi kwamba ile pesa katika budget yetu ilikuwa haiwezi kumudu kile kima ambacho kinatakikana kutekeleza mradi huu. Na hapo ndipo tulianza safari ya kutafuta usaidizi. Na Safaricom Foundation ikatushika mkono, ikatusaidia na kile kitita cha pesa ambako kilikuwa kimepungua milioni 15 na tukakiwekeza hapa, ndipo sasa hivi leo mradi umesimama na bila shaka wakazi wa Kilifi wameanza kuona ile faida na wataendelea kufurahia mradi huu.
Hii mradi itasaidia sana. Unajua hii hospitali inahudumia wakaji si tu wa Kilifi, ni karibu 500,000 people are treated in this facility or rely on this facility. So with the building of this unit, it is our hope that the maternal and child mortality rates will reduce significantly, not just in Kilifi County, but in the coastal county as a whole, because the coastal county is very intertwined. The borders are very, very porous and people go for treatment wherever they find it.
Well, that's all the news we had for you today on Metropole Business Center, but that's not all the show we had for you. At this point, I'm going to take a very, very quick break, but again, don't go anywhere, because like I promised at the top of the show, when I come back, I'll have the reigning Miss World Kenya, none other than Sharon Obara. We'll be right back.
There's so many reasons to love sports, but one thing stands out.
Numbers.
Straight from the big leagues.
Which is the biggest team in the English Premier League?
It is the numbers that make them stand out. Even when the muscles define the game, the numbers add value to the stats. Every swing comes with a number.
On SportsCenter, we go behind the game. On SportsCenter, we go behind the game for the numbers. Metropole Sports Center, at this time, only on Metropole TV.
Simone Biles is an American artistic gymnast who has a net worth of $10 million. Simone is the most accomplished American gymnast of all time, with a total of 30 medals to her name, both Olympic and World Championship medals. This tally also makes her the third most decorated gymnast in the world history, behind Vitaly Cherbo and Larissa Latinina. Some of her notable accomplishments occurred during the 2016 Summer Olympics, during which she competed as part of the U.S. team known as the Final Five. Many believe that Simone Biles is the greatest gymnast of all time. Simone Ariane Biles was born on March 14th of 1997 in Columbus, Ohio. Simone and her three siblings were constantly in and out of foster care while she was growing up. Her grandmother started playing an active role in her upbringing in 2000, and during this period, Biles grew up in the suburbs of Houston, Texas. Raised in a Catholic home, Simone maintained strong roots in Belize while growing up, as her mother is Belizean. To this day, she holds Belizean citizenship. At a young age, it became clear that Simone was destined for a career as a professional gymnast. She was subsequently pulled out of class and homeschooled for the rest of her secondary education. This allowed her to train over 33% more, and before she had attended university, Simone was competing in the Olympics at the highest level. Biles began her gymnastics career extremely early, and by the age of 8 she was training with coaches like Aim Borman. At the age of 14 she competed in the American Classic in Houston. She finished third. In 2012 she placed first at the American Classic in Huntsville. That year she was named to the U.S. Junior National Team. In 2013, she made her senior international debut at the American Cup before competing at the City of Jesolo Trophy and helped the United States team win a gold medal. Simone helped the U.S. team qualify in first place that at the 2016 Olympics, and she also qualified as the top overall gymnast in four of the five individual finals. She soon won her first Olympic gold medal at the team event, and she followed with a gold medal in the individual all-round category. She also claimed bronze at the balance beam final and another gold in the women's floor exercise final, for a total of four Olympic gold medals. After taking a brief hiatus from competing, she continued her gymnastic career with upgraded routines from 2018 onwards. In 2017, Biles began a relationship with Stacey Irvin Jr., who is also a gymnast. After 3 years of dating, the pair split up in 2020. That year, Simone announced that he had begun dating professional football player Jonathan Owens. In 2018, Simone joined many other current and past Olympians to accuse USA gymnastics physician Larry Nassar of sexual assault. Like many of her teammates, she claimed that USA Gymnastics played a direct role in allowing the abuse to continue over a long period of time, and she also accused the organization of attempting to cover it up. She decided not to attend trial of Nassar in 2018 as she wasn't emotionally ready to face her abuser. In 2020, Biles announced on social media that she had purchased a new home and she showed off a few pics of her new place. Not many details were published about her new residence, although it was clearly spacious and luxurious, with pictures showing tile floors and other details. Despite her famous frugality, it seems that Simone was willing to splurge a little on real estate, a smart investment. America's beloved gymnast announced on July 27, 2021 that she was withdrawing from the team competition following a stunning breakdown at a long-delayed 2020 Olympics, citing mental health issues and not an injury that was exacerbated by the pressure to be headstar at the Summer Games.
To bring the topic of mental health, I think it should be talked about a lot more, especially with athletes, because I know some of us are going through the same things and we're always told to push through it, but we're all a little bit older now and we could kind of speak for ourselves. But at the end of the day, we're not just entertainment, we're humans, and there are things going on behind the scenes that we're also trying to juggle with as well on top of sports.
After her unexpected departure, the U.S. women's gymnastics team ended up taking home the silver medal without 24-year-old Biles, a four-time Olympic gold medalist.
Welcome back to Metropole Business Center. And just like I've been promising right from the top of this show, even right before I took the break, and you know me, once I promise, I deliver. With me in studio, I have a real life beauty queen. First time in my life to actually share, what should I call it, a studio or even a space with a real life beauty queen. And joining me on the show is none other than the most recently and newly crowned Miss World Kenya, Sharon Obara. Welcome to the show,
Sharon.
Thank
you so much, Ingrid.
First of all, let me just say you're really looking the part.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
The first thought that came through my mind when you walked through the door was, I totally should have worn my evening gown. I feel so inadequate. Mm-hmm. But you look very nice.
Thank you so much.
Sharon, congratulations.
Thank you.
Very recently, just at the end of last month, mm-hmm. you were crowned, and just like your sash shows, Miss World Kenya 2021.
I was.
What's the journey like? What does this mean to you? Has your life already started changing? I mean, when you're walking on the streets, are you having people, you know, wave at you? What's the whole experience been like for you?
Well, first of all, I am really grateful. I am really grateful because this is such a big platform I've been entrusted with. This is a platform to push for change. It's a platform to better people's lives. It's a platform to better my own life. So since the crowning, life has indeed changed. It's really changed for me in all aspects. First of all, my social life has changed. Right now, I'd have people maybe wanting to take selfies, you know. My social media is also blowing up. It's really a great change, and I'm looking forward to walking this journey with all the grace and elegance that I can.
Right.
Yes.
But now let me ask, mm-hmm. and this is from like just other pageants. The reason I'm so excited is because I'm really, really into beauty pageants. Uh-huh. I think it's because I know I could never get there. So I really watch Miss World. I really, really watch all those pageants. Mm-hmm. And a lot of the times you'll see the winners say, this is a dream come true. I've dreamt about this from when I was a little girl. So Sharon, is this something as a little girl you dreamt about? Is this like a dream come true? Or is this something you picked up later along the way? Have you been someone who saw girly? Or is it one of those things where I was a tomboy along the way, someone saw I had a nice body and decided to encourage me? So what would you say about people who are trying to get into this space? Is it something that comes from, you know, what does the process look like?
So the journey is, it's really interesting. It's really interesting. And it takes a lot to be here. It's not just about the glitz and the glam, mm-hmm. the looking good. Mm-hmm. It actually takes a lot. So before you aim for such a platform, you have to be prepared. You have to be in a position where you have to be in that space where you love yourself so fearlessly. You are compassionate with yourself. You're patient with yourself because it's a journey. This is actually the second time I took the Miss World runway. I did it back in 2019. And as I said earlier, you have to be patient with yourself and compassionate. So I took time I stepped back. I looked at where I went wrong. I re-strategized. I worked on my shortcomings. I bettered my skills. So it's actually a journey. You also have to be fit. You have to be fit mentally and physically. You have to watch what you eat. You have to watch your diet. So it's a really great journey. And I'd say for me, it started a long time ago. I used to watch the show. It used to air on local television at around 10 p.m. So I used to dodge my sleep time to just get a watch of it. Mm-hmm. So going forward, I was really fascinated. But by then, the only perception I had of the pageants was the beauty stuff, like the nice hair and dresses. But coming, standing where I am right now, I understand that it's more than that. Mm-hmm. The theme for Miss World as a global organization is beauty with a purpose. So not only are you beautiful, but you are serving humanity. You have a purpose. You have something to give back to the society. So it's actually a dream come true, because this is a wonderful platform. I can't wait to impart change in as many lives as I can.
Right. Yes. And even before we get a lot more into impacting change and what you'd like to use this platform, you know, to do, I'd like you to help us, first of all, differentiate. Because I know you're Miss World Kenya, but then there's also a Miss Kenya pageant. Mm-hmm. So what's the difference there? And now what's your mandate as compared to now the Miss World Kenya?
I'm actually glad that there are a lot of beauty pageants platforms that are taking in diverse women and all. But then Miss World Kenya, this Miss World Kenya is among the big three pageants globally. So there is the Miss World, the Miss Universe, Miss International, Miss Supranational, and Miss Universe and Miss World. So they are the big five pageants. Yeah, the rest are good, but these are the main ones globally.
Right. Yes. Now, Sharon, to talk about your purpose, and I'm so glad you mentioned the fact that a lot of people think it's all about that glam. In fact, people think it's all about vanity. You know, she looks nice, she's wearing her tiara, she has a nice body, but they don't really understand that beyond that, there's a lot more that's expected. So you as Sharon, now that you have the crown, it's official, you're Miss World, what should we expect from you? What do you plan to, you know, what do you intend to use this platform for, to, you know, somehow impart change to the society?
Thank you so much. So going forward, I intend to use this platform to impart lives and bring about a positive change in our society. This year's theme is mental health, creating mental awareness and destigmatizing the issues surrounding mental health. The global pandemic, it took a toll on everyone. Everyone was affected in one way or another, and it's really affecting our mental health. So we intend to create more awareness and push for the intervening measures that people can actually reach out for help, and that it's okay not to be okay. Yes.
And actually, in line with that, I was doing a little bit of research before you came, like beyond now just being Miss World Kenya, I know you're in the special education needs bracket, right?
Yes.
So I would like you to talk to us about that, in line of what do you do, and maybe how is now your new crown going to feed into that space, if at all?
Yeah, so even before I joined the pageant, back then I was working with children with neurological and cognitive disorders. These are disorders that affect the brain functions and maybe our motor abilities. So there are disorders such as epilepsy, Down syndrome, and autism. So these are a special dosset of children. They're really special in that they require round-the-clock attention. And this can actually take a toll on the mental health of not only their caregivers or their friends or the people around them, but to them also, because it's hard fitting in. It's really hard for them fitting in, and they find it hard to make friends and everything. So what I've been doing with them, basically, we've been preparing fashion show events for them where they get to dress as the people they want to be in future. If one wants to be, let's say, a chef, a pilot or something, we mobilize the designers. So before then, before the main event, we spend like a lot of time with them. We bond with them, we do some activities with them, we help them color, you know, that bond. So on the D-Day, they get a chance to walk a runway. It feels nice, like they're really happy, they feel loved, they feel accepted, they feel warm. So that's what I've been pushing for also. And I also wanted to push for people to understand that they're not like this because they wanted to. It could happen to anyone. So at the end of the day, show them compassion as much as you'd love it to be shown to you, or maybe to another family member who might find themselves in that situation. Mm-hmm. So that's what we have been doing as special education professionals, and we intend to continue with the same spirit.
I mean, from what she was saying, it obviously seems like you have your work cut out for you.
Yes.
And it actually seems like it's a lot of work
Yes.
that you have to do. However, still for that little girl who's looking at you, like, you know, with those eyes at home, like, oh my God, I can't believe she's Miss World.
Uh-huh.
What would you say are the benefits? Because from what you're saying, it does sound like a full-time job.
Mm-hmm.
So from where you're sitting, what would you say are some of the perks from wearing that crown on your head? Is there some sort of payment that maybe if someone who's trying to join into this, you'll say, yeah, I'll be earning us. What are the benefits if I decide to get into this space that come with a crown?
For one, I'd say this is a very awesome platform because you get to become a better version of yourself. From where I'm seated, I have undergone trainings, fitness trainings, public speaking. There are etiquette classes. There are financial classes. So this is a really wonderful platform if you intend to grow yourself further. And also, it's a platform where you can push for a cause that is close to your heart.
Mm-hmm.
Like you, this is a chance you get to give back to the society or to make the change that you have always wanted to make. Then other than that, there are many perks in that you can get payments and you can also strike campaign deals. You can get to meet many people, you get to form like a broader social network. You basically become a good or a better or the best version of yourself.
Right.
Yes.
Now let's talk about, I mean, the pageant is a very big thing.
It is.
But if, depending on who you talk to or people who've even participated in this space, they'll say there's a lot of politics when it comes to arranging these pageants.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe there's not enough support.
Mm-hmm.
From your experience, what would you say in terms of support from relevant stakeholders, be it the government? Because I noticed when you were being crowned, there were actually a lot of high-placed officials from the government who are in attendance. Would you feel, and also without disputing the fact that someone like you can actually fully contribute to tourism in the country, believe it or not.
Yes.
You know, somehow you push the badge of the country.
Mm-hmm.
So in terms of getting the relevant support from the relevant stakeholders in government, would you say that's enough for people, for like for pageants or even such similar activities in the country?
Well, I'd say so far the support has been great. The shareholders came in different ways. Some came in to provide, like Trademark came in and it was the event venue. Magical Kenya came in, of course, because I'd be a Kenyan ambassador to the world. So they are part of it. Then other sponsors came in terms of clothing and everything. So the support is really nice and they have different dossets that they fit in. And also the support that I've gotten from out here is from my friends and family. It's been really great and overwhelming and I really appreciate it. However, the journey is just starting. Right now we are focused on the international crown.
Right.
The finals will be on 16th December in Puerto Rico. So before then, I intend to put in the work, to push myself to the limits and to become the best version that I can possibly, because I'm going not only to be representing myself, but Kenya.
Right.
Out there, I may not be called Sharon, but I will be Kenya. That's Kenya.
Right.
That's Kenya. That's Kenya. So I intend to put Kenya on the map. And in terms of support, I actually need people to support me because the votings are still on. We are voting on an app called Mobster. So they're basically trying to see how much support you have from people, from your country. So the support comes in terms of the votes. So on a daily basis, I'd be posting like, I'm already posting. I'd be posting like 5 to 10 pictures. So they vote for me by liking those pictures. So it's a daily thing. So that's how the people can support me and the shareholders, they're really coming in.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I'm still getting the support, the trainings, the clothings and everything. So I think everyone has a dosset, a specific dosset they fit in.
Right.
Yes.
And so you mentioned something about the pandemic and that's actually something we have to talk about.
Yes.
The pandemic has changed almost how everything is being done.
It has.
And I really feel like your industry has not been an exception.
Yes.
How would you say being named Miss World Kenya at a time where, you know, smack in the middle of a pandemic is going to somehow affect your role as the reigning Miss Kenya? And have you somehow thought about how then that's going to affect your delivery in terms of what everything you need to achieve?
So, excuse me. So the pandemic saw a shift in a lot of dynamics, like how we used to run ourselves, how we used to operate, how we used to do our things. So right now, as much as I might not be able to connect with people physically as much as I'd love to, I really love the fact that people are maximizing on their social media platforms. So I might not be there with you physically, but you can always access me virtually via the social media platforms and everything. So I do not intend to let the pandemic impede me from performing my duties. I will utilize the social media platforms and go out as much as I can and do as much as I can. Mm. Yes.
And finally, before I let you go, and I know you've really touched a little bit on this, but again, I speak for that little girl, and maybe me, I don't know, because I told you I had a dream.
Yeah.
For someone who's been, and I'll give you an example, or for example, the Olympics. Usually when you see the people who've competed in the Olympics, and you've even said it yourself, this is not your first rodeo. You tried it's in 2016, not. Finally you're here.
2019.
Even 2019, yes. Sorry. Even people who like will be in the Olympics, they'll say, I started training when I was five. Like there's a lot of work that has been put in. So again, for that little girl who's trying to sit in this exact seat, maybe they're like, next year I want it to be me. What does it take? What advice would you give? How did you make it?
Thank you so much. So from where I'm seated, I tell that little girl, go for it. But above all, self-love. That is the first thing I mentioned. You have to love yourself so fearlessly. Then you, compassion, you practice self-compassion. You appreciate how far you've come. You visualize how far you are, you want to go. And also, you know that keep going, keep going. And also you do your best, you do your best, and you put yourself out there, because at the end of the day, they say nothing comes on a silver platter. So I wouldn't be sitting here if I hadn't gone for it.
Right.
Put yourself out there in positions that will force you to grow. And above all, stay disciplined and determined to your course. Stick to the course. Yeah, that's what that's
maybe
what
one
say.
Last final thing.
Mm-hmm.
Again, because you've already even taken us through what you used to do before you got the crown, and now you have this new, I would say, job that you've taken on.
Yes.
Would you say it's a full-time job that whereby if someone is trying to get into this, you have to forget about everything else and fully devote to this? What would you say about that? Is it like a full-time commitment where you'll now just pretty much say, Ingrid, forget the fact about the fact that you're a journalist, because every day you have to be seen somewhere impacting lives.
Yes.
What would you say about that?
I'd say that being Miss World Kenya is actually a full-time job, because throughout the year you've been crowned, you have to be in service of the crown. So you need to be free. Your schedule needs to be clear. You are not supposed to be held down by other commitments, because some calls come in really urgently. You have to be flexible. You have to fit within the different schedules. So you have to. It's a full-time job. It's a full-time job that you're partaking. So give it a thought before you actually intend to go for it. But I'm not saying you don't go for it, but go for it when you're prepared, you're psychologically prepared, because this will now become your new reality. You are now in service of the crown. You'll need to do some humanitarian assignments. You'll need to meet different people. You need to sit in different meetings. So it's actually a full-time job.
As I'm looking at you over here with such perfect posture, I'm slouching over the table. I'm like, yeah, she's really a beauty queen. Sharon, thank you so much for making time to come to talk to
us.
We're so proud of you. We're rooting for you. And no doubt you're going to make it on the international scene.
Thank you so much.
So for our audience back home, that was Sharon Obara, the most newly crowned Miss World Kenya. And please follow her on her social media handles. Follow her cause and let's support her even as she goes to represent Kenya on the big stage. At this point, I'll take another very quick break. But when I come back, Stephanie Wasswa will be with me in studio to talk about the trending topics of the week. Don't go anywhere.